You're listening to Three Kitchens, a member of the Alberta Podcast Network. Locally grown, community supported. Join your host, Aaron Walker, Sarah Soma Syndrome, and Heather Dyer. What's on today's menu?
With Pod Power, our sponsors are making it possible for us to amplify the voices of Albertans and Alberta podcasters. This episode, Edmonton Community Foundation is helping us give a Pod Power shout out to CJSR presents High Level Hip Hop.
It's a deep dive into Edmonton's hip hop scene and the artists helping shape it. The show takes a unique approach to introducing listeners to the OGs and young bloods of Edmonton's hip hop scene. The show is aimed at those who love local music but might not have had a chance to fall in love with the city's surprisingly diverse hip-hop scene.
Each episode features an interview with a local artist, plus a fresh track they recorded at CJSR. Check out episodes with Arlo Maverick, Please Be Nice, and more throughout the season. High Level Hip-Hop is produced by CJSR, Edmonton's campus and community radio station. Download it wherever you find podcasts and at highlevelhiphop.transistor.fm. Welcome to Three Kitchens. I am Heather. I'm here with Aaron and Sarah. Good morning, co-hosts and friends.
Good morning.
It is morning. We usually do this in the morning. Hopefully we're awake enough. I feel a little borderline right now. I think I'm awake.
I have something I want to share with you. I did some research.
Mm-hmm.
Put on my nerd glasses. Actually, they're always on. So
I was going to say, those are just your regular glasses.
Also known as everyday for me. So I came across an article about people trying to grow saffron crocuses outside of Iran, because most of the saffron that we get comes from Iran. Mm-hmm. So I've got two stories. One is a happy story with a happy ending. One is a not so happy story.
Which one are we going to start with?
We're going to start with the downer.
All right.
So there is a family business that was run in Abbotsford, BC, in Canada here, and they were growing crocus down in Lower Mainland.
Well, Abbotsford is just further inland from Vancouver. I don't think it's too far from Vancouver. So Southern BC.
So we can call that the Lower Mainland, Southern BC?
Yeah, okay. I think that's, let's just go with that. Let's.
Okay, we're going to call it that. Clearly my research wasn't that good. Jeez. Somebody shame me for that. Okay. So for the last 5 years, they've been planting saffron crocus bulbs and doing quite well with it. And they had, I think it was like 250,000 bulbs or something. Wow. It was a huge, they were really starting to come into it. And so it was really interesting that they could grow it there. The saffron crocus bulbs are different than other typical crocuses. Mostly they grow in the spring. They bloom really quick and then they die off. And then they're just kind of a plant that's part of the grass. The saffron crocus is different. It blooms in the fall. It's very different than other crocus plants. And you have to pick the saffron threads, which are the stigmas of the flower.
Okay. She's so happy. She's so excited.
Because we talked about this once before, and we couldn't remember the name of the piece of the flower. Right.
Yes, I was super excited to now finally share that wisdom with you. Yeah. So these flowers, once they bloom, the day they bloom, you have got to pick the saffron and dry it that day. Is apparently the process. Each flower makes three stigmas that you get to pick.
Wow, that's really intensive work there.
When it happens, you have to be on top of it. And I think they bloom for about 3 to 4 weeks. Like all the, that's their sort of time period. Right. So once it starts blooming, they'll bloom for about 3 to 4 weeks. And every day you got to be out there checking them.
Right.
And so every bulb can produce up to about 10 flowers.
Okay. Oh,
so it just grows and then what, dies off? Like you pick it, it dies, and then it blooms again?
If you think about any other flowers, it'll have a bunch of buds on it. And as they open up and bloom, you pick it.
Right.
And as it the next one opens, you pick it. And so it's about a 3 to 4 week period.
I was picturing like a tulip grows from a bulb. You only get one flower and then it's gone.
Yeah, no, it's, you actually get a few flowers
Oh.
out of every bulb. It says up to 10. So I think that's at like maximum best.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Maybe not every single bulb you plant gets 10. They decided to experiment with this because of changes in climate, allowing them to plant different crops. And apparently a lot of farmers in the Lower Mainland have been switching up their crops because the climate has been changing and the market's changing. They're not getting as much for their blueberries or whatever they're growing. So they're trying up new things.
Okay.
This article was posted at the beginning of November about the Ramsar Berry Farm that was doing this. And then 3 weeks later.
Oh no, this is the sad part.
This is the sad part, guys. Hold on for it. The flooding that happened in Western Canada absolutely destroyed everything on their farm.
Right.
So they need to buy all new bulbs. Everything is just completely underwater, totally dead. So I don't think this farmer is going to continue with this.
Oh, that's too bad.
Which is really sad. They even had a thing with a restaurant in Vancouver who was, they only cooked with local ingredients, and now they were getting local saffron and they were incorporating it into their dishes and they were really excited about it. And now, womp womp.
Oh.
So is there no one else at the moment doing that in that area?
No. So the journalist said that they contacted the Ministry of Agriculture and all that stuff. It was the only farm that was producing saffron in Canada, in BC. There might be a couple more in Canada, but only one in BC. The next story about the saffron that I have is not local, but something that I think could be maybe developed locally. Rooftop farming of saffron crocus flowers in Paris. There are four sisters, because France has grown saffron in the past and their climate is good for it. But I guess with industrialized farming taking over most of their agriculture, you can't grow crocus in a big scale way because it's so labor intensive. And so they decided, what if we set up farms on rooftops? So they started out with two, but I think they're up to five rooftops around the city where they grow saffron flowers. I think they planted 60,000 bulbs, so a whole bunch. And they have all these like bags of soil, like large bags of soil that kind of seemed like sectioned off to be like square foot gardening raised bed bags.
Okay.
That they plant. So apparently the saffron crocus needs fairly dry soil, well draining soil, and they don't need to have any irrigation on it. So they can grow them in these bags on these rooftops. And they've got this whole thing going.
That's cool.
I'm going to do a terrible job of pronouncing this company that does this in Paris.
Let's hear it.
But we'll link to it in our show notes. It's called Bien Élevés.
So non-gardener question here. If you use, if these plants grow from bulbs, and once they bloom, do you then have to replant a different bulb?
No.
No, okay.
They just go somewhat
dormant.
They only flower once a year. They go through their plant cycle of growing their leaves, and then they bloom again in the fall, which again is unique because most crocus flowers bloom in the spring.
Okay. Yeah, interesting.
And I think that's a really smart way of doing a rooftop garden. They don't need as much time and care and attention during their vegetative growth stage. And you just have to be up there and on it once it flowers. And that's, you know, 4 to 5 weeks of intensive harvest and stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
You're done. So I feel like, where else could you get away with doing that on a rooftop? I think it's a really smart thing.
Calgary's pretty dry. I wonder if it would work here.
I wonder how it would do here, but if it's growing in BC,
maybe,
who knows? I think it depends on when we get that frost.
Maybe in a greenhouse.
Hey, maybe. No, speaking of greenhouses, I recently had the opportunity to chat with a local farmer, greenhouse, vegetable producer, market store owner, entrepreneur, crazy busy business person.
And mom.
And mom. I know. Like, just could she fit anything more in her day? No.
I don't think so.
Her name is Dawn Buschert, and she owns and operates Shirley's Greenhouse, as well as the Symons Valley Market Store, the old Uptowne Market. So she grows produce here in Alberta, and she sells it direct to customers at farmers markets and these market stores that she runs. Yeah, so I had an opportunity to ask her some questions about her business and, you know, kinds of things that she recommends to people in terms of shopping at farmers markets and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, fun. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Well, let's let our listeners hear that and then come back.
Yeah, stay tuned because we're going to be back after this, the interview. We'll come back and we'll talk about a salad that I made, speaking of produce.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so stick around for that.
Okay, great.
In Alberta, you get to choose who to buy your internet, electricity, and natural gas from. Park Power has low overhead, which in turn allows them to offer low competitive rates.
Reach out for a no-obligation comparison by emailing estimates@parkpower.ca. If you decide to switch, it's easy.
It's really just a change to your billing, and you can feel good knowing you are helping to give back to our communities with your utility bills. Learn more at parkpower.ca.
So hi, Dawn.
Hi.
How about you introduce yourself? Because I think last time I even missed one of your businesses in my description.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, for sure. So hi, my name is Dawn Buschert. I own Shirley's Greenhouse. I'm a farmer, and I also own Old Uptowne Market and Symons Valley Ranch Market Store. And I do run a little side market called WestSide Farmers Market in Calgary.
Oh, wow. I didn't know. See, there were four.
So okay. Tenacious is my middle name.
And busy.
Yes. I'm insane.
let's just say you're not only running like four businesses, you are a parent to three girls, teenagers. That's enough for anybody. So
and they're busy too, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Let's not forget that our lives are more than just our business, right?
For sure.
Yeah. So, okay. So your greenhouse, I was there a few years ago for one of those open farm day events. It's quite impressive to me, and not having been to like a large commercial sort of greenhouse, I don't know in terms of greenhouses, if you consider yourself large, but to me, it seemed quite large. So tell us, what is the scale of it and what do you grow there?
So my greenhouse is 36,000 square feet, so just shy of 1 acre. But actually for our greenhouse industry here in Alberta, that is very tiny. And so, so I'm just shy of 1 acre of greenhouse. In my greenhouse, I grow cucumbers, tomatoes, and peppers. I do grow some greens and sometimes some beans and, you know, just some fun stuff as well. And then I also do in the summer 20 acres of field crops, so 20 acres of vegetables. So can you picture your backyard garden and then times that by 20 acres? That's what we do. So
yeah,
always say they want a job working on the farm. And then I say, cause they like gardening. I want a job and work with you on the farm. Cause I like gardening. And I'm like, no, this is gardening on steroids. Like it's crazy. Yeah.
My mom always had a huge garden. I mean, we were on a farm too, and we had a huge garden, but I thought it was huge. It was, that's nothing compared to what you're doing. That was like a little hobby for her, you know?
For sure.
Yeah,
for sure. Exactly. But back in the day, our moms, I mean, my mom had a big garden too. That's how my parents fed us. Right. And so, you know, always picking weeds and picking, I got paid 25 cents per 5 gallon pail of weeds that I got picked, you know?
Oh,
so,
wow.
Yeah.
How do you keep on top of weeds, or do you?
So, weeds are a huge problem in my garden. And so what we do, I do grow in a layer of plastic. And so I put a layer of plastic down and then I put my transplants in there. So that takes care of most of the weeds. So we're weeding a little hole rather than the whole bed. Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, in a bed of carrots or a bed of lettuce, then we weed that fully, but we put our rows fairly close together and then we're not weeding the entire thing. And we don't actually do a whole lot of rototilling in between our beds. What we actually do is we take a lawnmower to it sometimes. And so we mow in between the beds because, I mean, weeds are green manure, like they're good compost. So we just, if you can catch them before they go to seed, you just put them right back in the soil and you work them in and, you know, it just builds that soil, right?
Oh, interesting. I never thought about using a lawnmower.
Yeah, no, we use a lawnmower.
Okay, so you are a second generation farmer. You were just talking about how when your mom had a big garden too. Your parents actually started the greenhouse business, didn't they?
Yes. So I'm a second generation farmer. My mother is Shirley. ironically enough, I get called Shirley all the time. I'll be walking down a mall and people will be like, Shirley, or they'll say, I know you from somewhere. And I'll say, yep, Shirley's greenhouse. And they're like, oh yeah, hi Shirley. And so, yeah, I'm a second generation farmer. So my parents had a greenhouse up by Airdrie and they grew long English cucumbers and they sold them to the warehouse, the warehouse that sells to the grocery stores, and they made a great living at it. So 15 years ago, they sold their greenhouse and we built ours. And we were going to do the same thing, long English cucumbers for wholesale and make a great living. And the problem is our mortgage was bigger and the natural gas went up and the labor bills went up. And so our bills were much higher. And the average price of a dozen cucumbers were roughly $7 a dozen when my parents were doing it. And even still in the summertime, they're $7 a dozen today. So you need the volume. And we just couldn't get the volume with, you know, just shy of 1 acre of greenhouse. So that's when we started planting tomatoes and peppers, and I started going to farmers markets. And so at a farmers market, then I can get $24 a dozen for my cucumbers, and that helps pay the bills. Mm-hmm. It makes it sound like I've got lots of money, but no, like last year, you know how in farming there's the phrase, there's always next year.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was saying that in about July last year with that drought. So barely made it through this winter.
Yeah, you really are a slave to the weather, whatever, you know, and the markets, people are willing to pay. And I mean, you know, we don't need to get into all that, there's a lot of factors that affect your business and what you're able to do.
The part that I love is that it's local food. And so I am a local farmer growing actual, like, local food, selling to local customers. When we think of our borders and we think of things like that, when COVID hit, I had phone calls of people saying, like, you have food, right? Because with the toilet paper wars, they were worried about their food. And so I said, yeah, I've got food. And so even still, like, I have food. It's pretty important. We need to keep strengthening our local food system and our local direct market food system is something that we need to focus on. You know, it's easy to pick stuff up in a grocery store that's local, but direct from a small farmer, that's even better.
Yeah.
It keeps the small farms alive.
Yeah. And so we've talked before about how you like to encourage people to get to know where their food comes from, right?
Yeah. And so when you're at a farmer's market too, like, it's always good to ask lots of questions. Who grew it? Where did it come from? When was it picked? How was it grown? You know, different things like that. Because not everything that glitters is gold at a farmer's market. And so one of the biggest giveaways at a farmer's market is actually stickers. If you see stickers on a bunch of produce, then you kind of got a question. Where did that produce actually come from? Is it actually local? And so, I mean, not always, it's not 100% guarantee, because when my cucumbers, they actually have the Shirley's Greenhouse wrap on them with the little barcode. And so they do look like something that you would buy in a grocery store. But yeah, it is, generally speaking, those stickers kind of give it away. Or what you do too is you also do research on that farm. So you take that booth or whoever you're buying from, and you do lots of research on them. And size of garden, size matters. So I know of a produce vendor, and they say, oh, we have a garden. But when you ask them, they have 2 acres of garden and they service, like, I don't know, 80 farmers markets in a week. Whereas I have 20 acres of garden and I service, like, you know, 15 markets in a week. And so, size does matter, because what happens too is they'll grow one row of carrots and then they say, oh, we grew all of these carrots. Well, you know, one row of carrots, it doesn't service 80 markets, right? So,
just, they're getting it from somewhere else.
Hutterites. Yeah. So, and I'll admit that I've bought and sold from the Hutterites too. But what I do is I say, these are Hutterite carrots. So then I always tell my customers, it's my job to tell you the truth and your job to make informed decisions. And so then, yeah, like, the customers can choose to either buy or not buy, right? Mm-hmm. In the wintertime, I buy in cucumbers, tomatoes, and peppers from Le Colme because my greenhouse is shut down because I don't have the grow lights. And so, yeah, I tell my customers exactly who grew it, where it came from, when it was picked, how it was grown. And then the customers can make their informed decisions. And I do lose customers over the winter, and that's okay. And then, but they always come back in the summer because they trust me, right?
Yeah.
It's a relationship. I view my farm as more of a relationship. It's a team. Without my customers, I don't have a farm. And without my farm, they don't have food. So it's a real team. It's teamwork.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And your farm is located east of Didsbury. Is that right?
East of Didsbury. Yeah. Yeah.
Didsbury. So central Alberta, for anyone not quite familiar with what we're talking about here.
Thank you.
You're in markets in Calgary,
I get around. So, one of my three jokes that I have. So I do farmers markets all through Calgary. I've got Olds Uptowne Market in Olds. This year, some of my products will be in Red Deer. So I do Bears Paw Market, Hillhurst Market, WestSide Farmers Market in Calgary. There's a whole bunch of other ones too. And I've got a little announcement to make. If you're familiar with the Calgary Farmers Market in Calgary, it's one of the bigger ones. I've never been able to get into there for, you know, there's lots of politics in farmers markets. And so I've never been able to get into that farmers market, but thankfully fellow farmers, great farmers, called Innisfil Growers, they've invited me to be part of their booth. And so I'm going to be a non-member farm. And so this year I'm going to have my product in the Innisfil Growers booth in Calgary Farmers Market 1, Calgary Farmers Market 2, and Red Deer Gasoline Alley Farmers Market with them. So nice. Farmers teaming with farmers. It's great. I'm thankful.
Yeah, it really is a community effort.
Yeah.
And speaking of that, that's kind of what your Olds Uptowne Market is about, which is a store in Olds, Alberta.
Yes. Yeah. And so exactly. And so that's the thing. Small businesses kind of need to work with small businesses. And so Olds Uptowne Market, I've got several vendors and small business vendors that they have their product in my store. And so that way we can team up together. So instead of having everyone have their staff representing their product, what I've done is I've provided the space, I've provided the staff, and then we work together as a team that way to sell their, get their small business product into a larger market, right? So
right, really cool. You're like your own mini farmers market.
It is. It's true. It's exactly what it is. And then that way too, we're able to be open 6 days a week, right?
I have yet to visit, but I don't get to Olds very often. I don't really used to have family in Olds, but I don't anymore. So I have I'm gonna have to make a special trip.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, we just moved to a new location, so it's bigger and yeah, it's pretty. I'm pretty happy with it.
Yay! I'm so glad.
Yeah.
All right. And then there's Symons Valley Ranch as well, which was a big institution. And then there was a fire and now it's like back. Like it's had quite a history.
Yeah, it does. And so I was a vendor during the fire. So Shirley's Greenhouse was a vendor during the fire and we actually did 40% of our business through that market. And so that year was pretty devastating. And so we ended up getting a little market store going. It's in a not a very nice building. It's in the basement suite of one of the buildings on site. And so it's not super pretty, but it doesn't have to be pretty. It's just functional. And so we've got our product as well as many of the other, there's still some of the vendors that were involved with the fire. They've got their products there as well. And so it's a smaller version of Olds Uptowne Market. So
now this is an interesting time of year for you. You don't get much time off, but as you said, you don't grow in the greenhouse and obviously not the garden during the winter, but you have, I mean, you're still selling.
Yes.
But right now your season has already begun. You've planted in your greenhouse, haven't you already?
Yeah. So I got my plants about 2 weeks ago. We got them in about a foot tall and I'll bet you those tomatoes are probably 3 feet tall right now.
Oh, wow.
So they are growing like weeds. I in the greenhouse, so it can be minus 30 outside. And with the sunshine and I heat it to plus 20. I mean, I'll trade you natural gas bills. I'll pay you 2 years of your natural gas if you pay a month of mine. Anyways, with the sunshine, those plants jump and they grow. And so, I should have cucumbers here within the next couple weeks for sure. And then tomatoes sometime in March.
Wow.
So my tomatoes are already flowering.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And it's really cool if you ever have a chance to go and see, because there's a type of tomato, for example, that grows like up a vine up to the ceiling. It's not like the bushy little plants that I grow on my back deck in a pot.
So my tomatoes are indeterminate varieties. And then we prune them in such a way that we only have one vine growing up the string and then we're constantly lowering them. So by the time I'm done with my tomato crop in late November or early December, my plants are sometimes 75 feet long.
Yeah, so it's really cool to see because that's how you make use of your space.
For
you
sure.
Up.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then we lower them and then eventually they're just vines on the floor that still grow up the string. So, and then I guess we should throw it in there right now too. So you came during Alberta Open Farm Days, and that is usually when I open my farm to the public. And so, Alberta Open Farm Days is usually in August every year. And so Alberta Open Farm Days is a great opportunity for people that are in cities and towns that maybe don't have have access. See, it used to be when we were young, your grandparent farmed, or you had an uncle that had a farm, or somebody had a farm. Whereas now people are so far removed from the farm that they just don't, the kids nowadays don't really know or see or understand. And so it's a great opportunity to bring kids from cities and towns out to farms, and not just my farm, but many farms across the province. And so you can go see a beef farm, and you can go see a grain farm, and you can go see a, you know, there's all kinds of farms out there that are open on during Alberta Open Farm Days.
Mm-hmm. And it's usually in August, I think, right?
Mid-August, I think. Yeah. It's fantastic. I think it's a great initiative. Great initiative.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's really cool. And I definitely want to get out to more. Oh, sorry. Somebody's got something to say.
I have three dogs on the farm. So I have a mini Australian Shepherd. So his name's Cowboy, and he's kind of our pet. But then I have two huge, like, Great Pyrenees, and they're out with my sheep. And so that's where they are. Their job is to be out with the sheep, and they're pretty shy. If you come into my yard, they're going to bark at you, but they're going to stay away from you. And yeah, their job is to protect my sheep.
So you have animal, like, livestock as well.
I do. So I've got right now, I'm just trying to get into the sheep. So I have 10 ewes and one ram. And then I'll have lambs. And then I've got 299 chickens for eggs.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Do your girls help out with them?
No, my girls hate the chickens. They love the dogs and they love the sheep, but they hate the chickens. So, yeah. My girls help me at farmers markets, actually. So it's pretty fun. We'll go to a farmers market and they'll talk and they'll chat with customers. And yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. That's nice too.
My youngest daughter, Danielle, she keeps saying to me, "Mom, I want to take over the farm." And she's 10. She's been saying it to me for about 2 years. "Mom, I'm going to take over the farm one day. Mom, I'm going to be the boss. Mom, I'm going to do your job." Yeah. Wow. So yeah.
That's so fun.
She's a little entrepreneur. Yeah.
Well, we see where she gets it. I mean, yeah, by it honestly, right?
There you go. I guess. The good, the bad, and the ugly.
Well, listen, any of us who have kids pass on all the traits. So what kind of tips would you have for us for storing our produce? Once we come and buy it from you, bring it home, where are we putting it? I have this mental block about tomatoes and the fridge. I always want to put them in the fridge. You tell me not to.
No. So tomatoes do not belong in the fridge. I think it messes with their flavor and their texture and everything like that. So tomatoes, leave your tomatoes on the counter. If you're buying my tomatoes, pull them out of the bag, put them on the counter. Don't put them with your bananas, because bananas give off ethylene gas, which will make them riper. Try and keep them in a cooler place. So don't put them in your south-facing window, because they're going to ripen up just real quick. And actually, cucumbers and peppers, they need to be in the plastic. My cucumbers and peppers, because they're so fresh, they can be on your counter for a few days or up to a week or whatever. It depends, you know, how they are. Or you can put them in the fridge. They actually like about 10 degrees. Like, if you had a fridge that was running at 10 degrees, not that anyone does, but that's where they would prefer. But
do you cook much? Do you even have time to cook much?
So no, I sacrifice meals at my table to put food on others. And so I don't cook very much, especially in the summer. I'm on the go. I'm on the road 6 to 7 days a week. I'm putting in, you know, 80, 90 hours a week. Like, I don't have time to cook. Having said that, I have three little girls who are, they're pretty good. And so it's been pretty cool. They're getting old enough now that I come home to homemade meals on my table from my children. So that's special.
Yeah. And you're running low on veggies, just head on outside and you've got it right there.
Exactly. And so I'll be honest with you. One of my go-to meals when I'm like in a hurry or tired at the end of a day is I will actually make a salad. So I'll take lettuce and cucumber and tomato and feta cheese and flavored olive oil. And then I mix that all together. And that's my supper, is, you know, a good salad at the end of the day. So
Nothing better than fresh like that.
Exactly. Know? Yeah. So good ingredients make good food. Bad ingredients make bad food. So
Okay. Yeah. So before I let you go, tell us where we can find you online. You have a website.
So shirleysgreenhouse.com. We'll be updating that coming up here in the next few months to figure out which markets we're at and which markets we're not. not add. And then let me think. So the main markets is Old Uptowne Market, Symons Valley Ranch Market Store, Hillhurst Sunnyside Farmers Market, Bears Paw Farmers Market, WestSide Farmers Market, a bunch of other smaller ones. And then in the permanent locations of Innisfil Growers. And then there's a few other smaller locations, but you'll have to check out online. Or we'll do home delivery to your home as well. So shirleysgreenhouse.com.
Right. Yes. Yeah. I noticed that last year we're recommending, you know, who knows of a delivery Shirley's Greenhouse pop up by a number of people who recommended it. So
I love it. Thank you.
Word gets around. Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Yeah. Thanks for talking with me.
No problem. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. And thanks so much for supporting my farm. I really appreciate it.
You're very welcome. We'll see you at the markets this summer for sure.
Sounds good. Thank you. Right. Take care. Nice to chat with you.
Okay. Yeah, you too. Bye.
Oh, that was so cool. I love hearing about greenhouse growing because you guys know that I have a little greenhouse. Mm-hmm. And my husband's always like, oh, that would be fun to go into business and do. I don't think it'd be as fun. It sounds like a lot of work.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I think it is.
Holy moly.
I think it's a lot of work. And like she said, she really has no downtime.
Right. No, it's a full year thing.
Yeah, farming in Alberta is seasonal. Except that you need to keep your business running.
Yeah.
And it's a short season, like, I mean, for growing here.
Yeah.
Yeah. But with the greenhouse, like she said, really she helps, plants, right. she put her first plants in early in February and she usually pulls them early December, the last of the veggies, early December. So she really like
it's
maybe
not that
2 months.
Much of a break.
And she's still operating her stores and
you know,
still selling and managing people and, you know, all the things that go along with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think that's so neat though. It's interesting to hear about how you can extend the season with that greenhouse. And
yeah. And I thought it was interesting what she said about knowing where your food comes from. You know, we talked about this a little bit with Chef Dennis Litley, who we had on the podcast a couple episodes ago.
Yeah.
And he said the same thing, and he's in Florida. He's not a farmer or producer, but he's talking about when you're cooking, what are you cooking with? And they both said the same thing. When you have good ingredients, you have good food. If you have bad ingredients, not such
you're
good food.
You're not going to like it. Right? No, you're a farmer.
Mm-hmm. And the food tastes different, right? I keep being reminded of those bell peppers that your husband grew. I mean, you cannot get flavor like that at the store, at the grocery store.
No. Mm-hmm.
And I personally, those like cherry tomatoes that Dawn grows in Shirley's greenhouse, it's like candy.
Yeah.
When I have the opportunity, I admit I don't go to the farmer's market as often as I would like to. I would like to make a better effort because it really is a huge difference from what you buy in the grocery store.
Right. And she sets up in Kensington, right? The Kensington market?
The Hillhurst is the closest one to us.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right. And that's she's going to be at those, the Calgary Farmers Market, getting in there now with the Innisfail growers. That's great. Yeah. What a fantastic opportunity.
Yeah. I love how farmers will work together.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Like we've come across a few.
At the Poplar Bluff Organic Farm.
Yeah. And they all seem to work together and know each other and support each other. And that was pretty cool.
And I think that's something that's really important. It's a collaborative effort. You have to work together.
Yeah.
And we know that with all the variability that we get here in our seasons and year over year, that's a scary thought that your food relies on the climate. I sometimes don't think we're as in touch with our food as we need to be to understand how delicate the balance is.
Yeah, I mean, Dawn even mentioned the droughts last year really impacted her garden.
Yes,
it was touch and go for sure.
So when we get all this delicious fresh vegetables, what can we do with them, Heather?
Oh, okay.
Tell us about your...
So yes, I made a salad for you because we were talking about produce and the greenhouse and all that kind of stuff. Yes, I shopped at the grocery store. I'll just say it out there, but this is the kind of recipe, this salad, that you could do with stuff you grow in your backyard in a pot or from that you get at the farmer's market.
Or it could be from winter salad garden down in the basement on our light rack. We've got spinach and chard going on in trays in the basement. It's fantastic.
Absolutely. So this is called the spicy roasted carrot salad with tahini and lentils. And I found it on a website called Occasionally Eggs
shirley.com.
Did you know we have a huge lentil production in Alberta too?
Mm-hmm.
It's one of our biggest, the pulse crops, I think they call them. Yep. So even the lentils are local.
Well, I don't know about the ones I bought, but you can get them locally. That's true. So let's just
make it local.
You make it as local as you can. I was just trying to pick something that you could change up any which way you want too.
Right.
Mm-hmm. This is made with roasted carrots. I also threw in a couple beets because I saw those at the store and I love roasted beets. But I mean, you could do any kind of roasted veggie that you like. Okay. So the carrots and beets are tossed with olive oil, sea salt, black pepper, cayenne pepper, and sumac.
Ooh.
And then roasted.
Okay.
That's what gives them a little bit of a kick, right? The cayenne. Yeah. And then, of course, you cook up your lentils. Remember to soak them in advance. And I was thinking that if you didn't have time to soak lentils, something like quinoa or like wild rice, maybe, or something.
That would
just
be good,
to give it like a little protein.
Yeah, it fills you up.
Yeah, kind of makes a meal out of it, right?
Even chickpeas would have been great, right?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so you cooked your lentils, you roasted your vegetables, then you put those on a bed of greens. We just talked about spinach or microgreens or whatever kind of leafy lettuce, whatever you like. And then the dressing that goes on top is made with olive oil, tahini, balsamic vinegar, Dijon mustard, maple syrup, salt, and garlic. And it makes this super thick, like I just put it in a jar, shook it up, and it was like, it looked like peanut butter almost. It was like super thick.
Yes.
I opened your jar thinking it was peanut butter.
Yeah.
And I went to smell it and I'm like, hey, what is this? It was so good.
We were playing what's in this dressing game as we ate it. My husband picked out the balsamic vinegar. I was like, ooh, you're right. Good job.
I think the tahini maybe with the vinegar almost to me was like peanutty. Didn't you think?
Yeah.
Super yummy. And just a bit of a different flavor. And I thought when my kids had it, they didn't want the lentils. They had avocado.
Oh, yum.
For that kind of creamy texture with it. I thought you could throw feta on there, strawberries. I don't know. Like you could make this however you want.
Boiled egg.
Oh, yeah.
Hard-boiled egg would be really good with that. We really enjoyed that. That was fantastic, Heather.
Yeah. So if you're going to pack it in your lunch, just cool everything first.
Right.
Then you can pack it all together.
Yeah. It was very good. And perfect timing because it was a day after Super Bowl. Eating so much meat and protein. That salad was such a, it was so good.
Yeah.
And filling was really filling.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I thought the lentils kind of filled you up, right?
Yeah. I love lentils so much.
And I ate a beet.
I put them separate because I was like, I don't know if Sarah's going to want the beets. I'll just give them to her separately.
I did. I will eat beets.
It's okay if you don't. That's totally fine. Life's too short to eat things you don't like.
Yeah, exactly. I thought that was fantastic.
It was good. It was really good. And that dressing was good. And I loved the heat from the cayenne pepper. That was, I always love spice. So that was great. Thanks, Heather.
You're very welcome. So now when you go to the farmer's markets, everyone, go and buy your veggies. You can make a salad. And it's almost everything you could get locally. Maybe not tahini. I don't know if that's made locally.
Yeah. And your olive oil is probably not local.
That's true. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I hope everyone enjoyed that little interview with Dawn. She's super passionate about farming and growing and local. And just like when you're talking about the saffron story, that wouldn't be possible without a market, without people willing to support local business and go search it out and bring it home and cook with it. So the more we can support our local businesses, the more creative ideas will come out, right? Like, because there's a market of people who want to buy local, this person said, maybe I can grow saffron here. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And maybe it didn't work because of nature.
Mother Nature can be a bit of a bag sometimes.
Yeah.
But then you just have to figure out how to do it differently. Like this rooftop thing. I'm like, oh my gosh, genius.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or it'll be something else. Like people are very creative and we'll meet the people with something new, right? Like if you're willing to come and support me, I'm going to come up with something that you're going to want.
So, and this movement to doing more urban agriculture, I think is really smart because
we have a huge population living in urban areas. Mm-hmm. They say it's going to increase even more over the next 20 years. Obviously, we can't go and have an entire wheat field on top of our roofs or whatever, right? But trying to make little differences in the way that we produce our food makes a huge impact on the environment and on the transportation and food scarcity and, you know,
the economy and local jobs.
Diversify. And the more people there are, the more ways we do stuff and the more diverse it is, the better our chances of it going forward into the future.
Right.
Just like Darwin said. Okay, I'll stop there.
She had her finger in the air.
I was going to quote Darwin, but then I held back.
Don't hold back. Don't hold back. You already put on your nerd glasses. It's okay.
The species that survives is not the biggest or the strongest. Rather, it is the most flexible. Mm. So
there you go.
Remember that, friends.
Let's just once more let people know to look up shirleysgreenhouse.com.
Yes. And we'll link to it in our show notes.
Yeah. Go support them and all their farm friends.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's got
find your local farmer's market and find your local farmer and find out where your food comes from.
And now for the fine print. We at Three Kitchens gratefully acknowledge we are telling these stories in the traditional territories of the Treaty 7 Nations in Southern Alberta and the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3. We honor the rich tradition of oral storytellers on this land who have come before us. You can find pictures and recipe links on Instagram and Facebook at Three Kitchens Podcast. If you like and subscribe on your podcast player, that helps more people find us.
Thank you, farmers.